welcome to my channel, or welcome back if you've been here before. My name is Beth Ann, and today I want to talk a little bit about Gods of Jade and Shadow by Silvia Moreno-Garcia. And this is a book I read in December. It was a pick for one of my real life book clubs. And I also want to say that I used the book club journal to take notes about this book. And this was something that I wanted to give away on Margaret Pernard's channel. And this is a pretty cute book club journal. So mostly it's just spreads like this, where you would do one book per spread. You can record data about the book, some quick notes on your analysis, who would you recommend it for, what are the main themes, those sorts of things. Then you can circle, fill in some star ratings for various categories like writing style, relatability, readability, etc. And then a whole big section for notes and your biggest takeaway. So I've been using this exclusively for books that I'm reading for book clubs, because those are usually books where I actually want to take notes and remember things so that I can talk about the book with other people. So I'm hoping I won't fill this up too quickly, because it's fun to use for books that I want to be able to talk to people about. So yes, the first book I used it for was Gods of Jade and Shadow. So this is a I think it's categorized as historical fantasy romance. It's set in 1920s Mexico, largely in the Yucatan Peninsula, although there's some travel through other parts of Mexico and even up to like El Paso in Texas in the course of this book. And then the fantasy part is actually, it's not really fantasy, I mean it's myth. It's the actual myths and folklores and legends of the peoples of Mexico, and in particular a lot of it is Mayan, although there's a few things that come from other peoples that I had never heard before, like the Huastec people. There's a god in here from those people. So I just don't really understand how those categories are defined. You know, it's like, do we call the Bible fantasy because it's myth? So I sort of feel that way about this book, where, yeah, in a way it sort of feels fantastical in the way of literature that's not taking place in the world that we can see and feel and hear and smell. But I hesitate to call the myths and folklores of cultures fantasy, if that makes sense. So I don't know if anyone has thoughts about that. Let me know down in the comments, and if you've got good articles or something that you've read that talk about that, I'd love to learn more about that distinction. But anyway, so this book, steeped in Mayan folklore and mythology, and in particular, the main plot of the book follows the sort of adventures and misadventures of the Mayan death god, Uncame. So in the beginning of the book, we meet Cassiopeia, who is a young girl slash woman. She's sort of on the cusp of adulthood, and she and her mother are sort of the poor relations in her grandfather's house. Her grandfather's family seems to have a lot of European influences. Her grandfather was very well off by the standards of the time, and her mother sort of disappointed the family, it seems, by marrying someone with much more direct Mayan ancestry. And when Cassiopeia's father died, she and her mother became the poor relations. So there's a little bit of a Cinderella origin story at the beginning of the book. But one of the things that I really love about this book is the strength of the female character. So she says explicitly at one point in the book that I wasn't waiting to be rescued. You know, even though I looked like sort of a woman in distress, damsel in distress, I didn't need to be rescued, because I would have gotten the life that I want anyway on my own, regardless of whether the adventures in this book had happened or not. So I really, really like that, and I thought the main female character was really powerful for that reason. So so she pretty quickly in the beginning of the book stumbles into a plot and a past and an adventure that really has nothing to do with her in a way. She discovers the bones of the death god Uncame, who had been betrayed by his twin brother and rival, Vukubkame. And it turns out that her family a couple generations back had been involved in that, and Vukubkame had scattered some of the body parts of Unkame around around Mexico. And so then the rest of the book becomes a quest as Cassiopeia is tied to Unkame and has to help him find his body parts and have a final showdown with his brother. So in that sense, it's in some ways a pretty standard arc, because you have this coming of age element of this girl is taken out of her small town, sort of rural upbringing, and exposed to a much greater world, and she discovers her own strengths and will through the course of these adventures. She discovers the power that she has, even in a world where gods still exist. So it has that sort of tropey arc, but presented in a really cool way. So some other things that I liked about this are, even though, you know, this pretty uneducated, unworldly girl is thrown in with these gods, the book explores some of the limitations of being immortal, and then some of the powerful parts of being human and being mortal. And so Cassiopeia, through the course of the story, she does sort of introduce the gods to sort of feelings and the right way to have relationships and the idea of maybe proper communication. And it's not like the gods really change that much, but also just for Cassiopeia herself, as part of herself coming into her own power as a woman, she becomes very aware of the limitations of even these supposedly very powerful male figures. So I liked that a lot. There's a lot in here also about the power of belief. So the idea that gods have power to the extent that they're believed in, and that's the original source of conflict between Unkame and Vukubkame, is that Vukubkame, these are Mayan gods, and so with the decimation of the Mayan people, they were sort of losing power in, I think it's called the Middle World, in our world, and Unkame was sort of okay with that, at peace with that, and was happy to just stay in the underground, in the Mayan underworld. And Vukubkame was not. He wanted to get worshippers back. He wanted to bring back the sacrifice and ritual worship. And so just that idea that things have power to the extent that we give them power. They have power to the extent that we believe in them. And of course, you can apply that to gods, like in a mythology in this book, but you can also apply it to things like the stock market. Collective belief has power and meaning. So I really liked that. Yeah, then I guess just going back to Cassiopeia's growth, I mean, of course, you can tell that's the main thing that appealed to me about this book. But at one point, she's having an internal monologue where she realizes that the space that she got from her home situation, which was really bad because she was the poor relation, like I said, Cinderella story, so she was doing all of this really difficult manual labor around her grandfather's house. And in particular, she had a cousin about her age who was essentially abusing her verbally and a little bit physically, you know, just as keeping her in her place sort of thing. And there's backstory to that we see revealed through the book. But then once she has space from that situation, she's able to understand the family dynamics more. She's able to understand how this cousin felt more and where he was coming from, and have some empathy for the other members of her family, even though they were treating her badly. So she just, yeah, she really just gets this maturity and growth. And I don't want to do any spoilers, but she just has a really wonderful, just a really wonderful development as a character. Okay, I think that is maybe all the most of the babbling that I want to do. Oh, I just wanted to do one final comment on just the writing style of this book, which I really, really loved. At first glance, it's very spare and simple, but it's packed with beautiful imagery, but it's just simple despite having these amazing images. And I think part of that, I don't know if this was deliberate on the part of the author or not, and I haven't read any of her other books, although I'm now going to, but it sounds like a myth as I was reading it, just the style of the writing, like it's almost a little detached, and it's in the third person. And so it does sort of just have that sense almost of, you're hearing a myth being told to you. So I don't know if that was me taking too much to heart the setting or not. I'd be curious what other people thought of the writing style, but I just loved that, just that little bit of a sense of detachment, And then just beautiful, sparse, simple writing. I thought all of her writing was just very clear and concise, and absolutely beautiful. So I think that's basically what I want to say about this book. It was a 5-star read for me. I would love to read it again someday, and I will absolutely be recommending it to anybody, and buying it as a gift for folks. Although most of the folks in my life that I know who would like it, I think have already read it or know about it from this real life book club. But anyway, 5-star book, Gods of Jade and Shadow. Let me know in the comments down below if you've read it, if you are a booktuber who has a video about it. I would love to go watch it. So let me know if you've reviewed it somewhere. And if you're not a booktuber and you've read this, I would love to hear what your thoughts are as well, down in the comments below. So with that, I'll sign off. But thanks for watching. I'll see you all in the next video. Thanks. Bye.